Ravishankar currently hold the position of senior general manager at Sun Pharmaceutical Industries Limited and leading team involved in analytical activities related to development of biologics. Prior to current role, he was also additionally leading team involved in analytical activities related to new chemical entities and bioanalytical activities pertaining to drug metabolism and pharmacokinetics, that is DMPK at Spark CL. He is postgraduated from Gujarat University with Master of Pharmacy, that is in Quality Assurance, and University of North Gujarat with PhD in Pharmacy. He is recipient of Young Pharmaceutical Analyst 2008 award from Indian Drug Manufacturing Association. He is having more than 18 years of experience, and his research interest includes method development, validation, and transfer of analytical methods for release and stability testing of drug substance and drug product of biosimilars, along with extended characterization. He was also responsible for analytical and bioanalytical method development and validation, PK/TK analysis and its evaluation, in vitro and in vivo metabolism studies, bioanalytical support to CYP inhibition, metabolic stability and permeability studies for new chemical entities, and dose formulation analysis. So with this brief introduction, I invite Dr. Ravi Shankara to deliver a talk on analytical comparability of biosimilars, current regulatory expectations and challenge. Over to Dr. Ravi Shankara.
Thanks, doctor, for introduction, nice introduction, and thanks for providing an opportunity to present whatever the learning I have in a brief stint. I'm working at Sun Pharma and taking care of biologics as well as peptides. So that's my brief introduction. So my slides are visible.
Simple. You
Okay,
can make it
great.
slideshow on.
Okay, so I think
Yes.
perfect. Yeah, so I'm going to touch upon a couple of aspects of analytical comparability of the biosimilars. This is from the biosimilar perspective. This is the most important part where regulators look into very closely, I should say, with the zoomed lens, double zoomed lens on this part. And what is current regulatory expectation? So, and along with that, what are the challenges the biosimilar developers are facing, and how they are responding to each and every queries of the regulator? So I'm just touching upon certain aspects of these parts. So moving to the next slide. Yeah, so as the last speaker touched upon a couple of aspects, and you were gradually learning all these aspects, I'm not touching much on that, but only one thing I just wanted to emphasize on this part is the large molecule, or you can call it as the biologics, in terms of therapeutic proteins, vaccine, mAbs, fusion proteins, like ADCs. So the size matters. The size of each and every biologics is 200 to 1,000 times bigger than the small molecules. So everybody knows that kind of, I mean to say, the characterization of the small molecules itself is a bit difficult, but characterization of the large molecule is, it's really a Herculean task because of their complexity. The other important part are they're highly sensitive, because since they're a protein, they are in three-dimensional structure. Always the vulnerability of the changing their nature, their structure is always feasible. So that is most important part when it comes to keeping the protein intact and live, I should say, to get a maximum efficacy. So moving to the next slide, just a definition from two big regulators, US FDA as well as European Medicines Agency. Both of them expect highly similar, I should say, comparable biosimilars. So the biosimilars should be highly similar in terms of safety, efficacy, and similarity perspective. So it's that they won't withstand a minor differences. If at all there is a minor differences, we should justify strongly on that. So similar, the expectation of European Medical Agency also. So for that, they are expecting comprehensive comparability exercise. So that is where many aspects comes into the picture. So when we talk about physicochemical characterization, so we do a biological characterization, then followed by preclinical studies, then PKPD and the clinical. So the most important part is biological characterization. So moving to the manufacturing aspect of the protein. So everybody knows that how the, I'm just targeting the monoclonal antibody or a recombinant protein, how you are producing the recombinant protein, just to have just a flow chart kind of a thing. So you need to have a desired gene of interest, which would eventually produce your protein of interest. So this gene you are inserting into the vector, and you will have a host cell that needs to be expressed. Then after expressing that, we are going for a cell culture. Then you need to have a cell bank. So cell bank is most important. When we have a cell bank, you have a mass. Initially, it starts with the research cell bank. We call it as during the developmental phase, followed by a master cell bank and a working cell bank. So this cell bank is extensively characterized for multiple aspects. That's the most important from the regulatory perspective. The cell bank should be thoroughly characterized. The source of the cell should be well defined, where you have purchased this source, what is a complete information on the vector, complete information on the gene, and the complete information of the cell needs to be provided to the regulator, right? So using that cell bank, so the master cell bank is your gold or a diamond. So it should be preserved in multiple places, because from there, every time you prepare a working cell bank, and the working cell banks will be used for your routine production. Okay, so master cell bank is most important for all the biosimilars. Then once we have the cell, you have the protein will be produced, and with upstream process, then it will be purified by downstream process. Then there's a lot of analytics will be done, a lot of analysis will be done from the release perspective, and then from the characterization perspective. That's most important. Currently, we are talking about the drug substance. Then you will go with the formulation. So the last speaker has extensively covered all the aspects of the formulations, nicely covered on those parts. So one of the important, once again, in the protein area is formulation plays very important role in the stabilization of the protein. So what exactly, which component needs to be added, and many other aspects are certainly helpful on this part. Then moving to next part is the storage and handling of that. So here, I should quote one thing is, it is impossible to produce exact copy of the reference drug. So that's most important. I'm talking from the biosimilarity perspective, you cannot do that, because the host cell there is a slight difference in the host cell, there is slight difference in the manufacturing process, and a lot of things are different here, including a small change in the bioreactor will give you a different profile, okay? And so this heterogeneous mixture of protein molecules are different in physical and chemical biological properties. So the variation is known from the manufacturing process and other aspects, but we have to prove the biosimilarity considering all the aspects. That is the most important part. So moving to the factors which are attributing the similarity of the biologics. So as I mentioned, master cell, culture condition, purification and formulation are related to the manufacturing, and physicochemical, biological, PK and PD is related to the quality. Eventually, considering everything in a nutshell, what we have to prove is, from the similarity perspective, is efficacy, it should be similar, safety, it should be similar, and immunogenicity, this is more important part, that should also very, very negligible, okay? So it should not be there. That's the expectation from the regulators. So yeah, this is just an example where agendas like most of the speakers will add on that. So the top portion is MAP having a molecular mass of 150,000 Dalton, whereas aspirin is 180 Dalton. So characterization of aspirin is really, really a difficult task when we talk about from the small molecule perspective. But look at that big complex molecule, each and every amino acid should be determined, and any post-translation modification in any amino acid should also be checked in, and the quantitation should be done on that part, and the primary, secondary, and tertiary structure should be well established with multiple techniques. So that is the most challenging part. Having said that, if you look at the down, and this pasted the isoelectric focus gel of an isoforms of one of the biosimilars. So I have added the name, so you can make out which is what. So if you look at that, there is a US, I am calling it as innovator. And there are China production and a Korea, then even India. There are multiple people are producing that, right? So however, I should say there are differences in the isoforms, but all of them have well defended on this part. Like whenever we talk about in this area, so most of them have well defended. So how they have defended, even though you have a differentiation. So what I mean to say here, even though you have a differentiation in the product, but with the secondary structure, if you can like defend to the regulators, then you will get an approval on that part. So moving to the characterization, probably I'm not touching upon many aspects on this because this is a separate area on this part, but there are multiple techniques used for and multiple characterization has to be done. So like intact mass, primary sequencing, disulfide, N-terminal sequencing, CSDS for reduced and non-reduced, isoelectric focusing, glycan, then secondary tertiary structure with CD, then charge variants, PTMs and aggregations. These are the major quality attributes which we need to take into the consideration of many of the aspects. So there are multiple characterization tools when we talk about which can be utilized to prove similarity by multiple orthogonal techniques. So for the same, for example, aggregates, you can go with SEC, you can size exclusion chromatography, you can go with GLS, dynamic light scattering, you can go with AUC, analytical ultracentrifuge. There are multiple techniques, so they are orthogonal. But yes, you will observe some kind of difference between one technique to another technique, but same time our objective is whenever using one technique, whatever I'm getting over there in the percentage of aggregates or whatever the representation, it should match with the innovator. So that's the most important part we are taking into the consideration. So moving into the next slide, so this is a triangle. When we talk about, small molecule, the triangle will be reversed, where like regulators are giving most importance on the non-clinical and clinical sections, whereas like for the biologics, it is always the other way around. The regulators expect most of the analytical studies. So here comes a lot of opportunities for students who are working in that. So there are multiple areas. When we look into the earlier slides, so you have n number of techniques. So each technique one can master. So that would give us a chance to make our career in that direction. For example, if you are using high resolution mass spec, so that's entirely a different field where our career can be built. So for physicochemical characterization, that's totally different with multiple instrumentation. So eventually what I mean to say is from the analytical analysis is most important when it comes to biologics. So now coming to the regulatory expectation. So what are the factors to be considered for performing comparability analytical assessment? So which are the factors that needs to be taken into consideration? So most important here is expression system. Okay, which kind of expression system you are using? If you are using a different expression system, then most of the time we are ending with the trouble. It's very difficult to prove the similarity if we are using the changing the altogether an expression system. But we can use a similar expression system versus show. Okay, but the cell can be purchased from two different vendors with a similar platform. Okay, then manufacturing process. Yes, any change in the manufacturing process will lead to change in your final product. Physicochemical properties needs to be thoroughly evaluated. Functional activities needs to be thoroughly evaluated. A target binding should be evaluated. Impurities, there are two kinds of impurities, process-related impurities and degradation-related impurities. So both of them need to be thoroughly evaluated and compared. Then reference product and reference standards. So that's most important. Both, like all the regulators, give at most importance to the reference standard. So it starts from the clinical batch and to every time qualifying your reference standard so that your potency should not be compromised, your content should not be compromised. Then the finished product and the stability. So these are the two most attributes that needs to be taken into consideration. Okay. Moving to next slide. So comparative analytical data, which provides a foundation for the development of a proposed product, which can be submitted at different levels. So how you can approach regulatory. Okay, that's the most important point everybody is looking at. So I need to start working on, if I am working on a biosimilar, so what is the way forward? So initially start developing a biosimilar, have a preliminary comparative analytical data that supports initial advisory meeting. So you have to approach to the regulatory with advisory meeting. Hey, look, I'm developing such and such biologics, biosimilars, and this is what my preliminary comparative analytical data. With this, I'm going to do, like my program is such and such. So I mean to say, I have to give a brief a way forward or a work plan, I should say, to regulatory and get a concurrence from that, okay, whatever I'm doing is right. Otherwise, what happens? Any change they propose may take, if they say, no, I'm not accepting your, I should say, production system, then if you approach them later stages, your 3 years work will go in a way. So that's most important. So go for a preliminary advisory meeting. Then with the comprehensive comparative analytical data, we can approach for pre-IND stage. Then you can go to the IND submission after having the complete data. Then with the initial clinical stage such as PK/PD. So second, like I mean to say, you can approach lately to prove your efficacy on the part. So, there are multiple expectations related to the CMC. Okay, so that is that's where everybody is working comprehensively on the CMC data. So there, the most important part is rationale for approach of a comparability analytical assessment. So how we were assessing each and every quality attributes, that is most important. Then the capability of the method, right? So you are using some method. So what is the capability? What is the differential factors, I should say, how your method is capable to differentiate any minor changes? That is the most important. And the next part is in-depth chemical and physical comparison. Like it's always by side by side. So generally what happens, you will have reference, it should be compared minimum at least 5 lots of reference standard versus 5 lots of our product. So in that perspective, it is always recommended to have a head-on comparison. We call it as head-on. Means every time when you do analysis, you run the RLD, you run our product, and then get a comparison. So if you compare data on 1 year back, obviously the analytical error, whatever may be, that would like attribute significantly, and that may changes. Then a number of lots. What is the number of lots you have to use? Current expectation I'm going to take up in the next couple of slides, but that's also well defined. Next, lot of reference standard should be identified. Which lot? What is the expiry date? So the expectation from the regulatory is you need to use a initial, mid, and near expiry RLDs to prove the degradation pattern of the impurities, to look into the degradation of the pattern. So they're calling it as the age-related RLDs, like reference products, okay? Then acceptance criteria. You need to well-defined acceptance criteria should be there for a comparability assessment. Then you have to have strong orthogonal qualitative methods to identify the differences. That's most important. You have size exclusion, but at the same time, you have to use DLS and AUCs to prove that by various different techniques, I'm getting a similar quality, similarity. So that's most important. So differences introduced by any design or observed through the testing shall be described and it should be discussed, okay? So let's touch upon each and every aspect what I defined in the first slide a little bit elaboratively. The first is expression system. So the expression system is nothing but it's a construct to encode the same primary amino acid sequencing. So the sequence should be same. There is no compromise in the primary amino acid sequencing. So only differences what they can allow is minimum differences between the expression system, that is host cell. Okay. If at all you are using a different expression system, then that needs to be evaluated case by case. Okay. So there are well-defined guidance on it. The second part is manufacturing process. So the manufacturing process are well covered in multiple ICH guidelines, Q8, Q9, Q10, and Q11, which is related to the development, risk management, quality system, and development and manufacturing of the drug substance. So the process change and comparative between the pre and post changes should be demonstrated. If any change happens at any period, so that we call it as stage one, stage two, stage three. So accordingly, there will be always be a bridging comparability study should be demonstrated from process one to process two, process two to process three. Okay. The next part is physicochemical properties. So what are the things which needs to be considered for the physicochemical properties? Here, the primary structure, secondary structure, tertiary structure, and the quaternary structure. Apart from that, post-translation modification and the functional activities. Okay. So the functional activities can be derived from two ways. One is binding and second is functionality perspective. Okay. So here also more than one analytical procedure should be adopted to evaluate the quality and use of orthogonal methods for independent data and analysis. The quality attribute should be used. Then whatever test we are using, it should be scientifically sound and fit for their intended purpose. So that means what is the expectation from the regulatory is you need to provide certain degree of assurance by performing. I am not calling as a validation of every method, but at least I should call it as a qualification of each and every method. That's most important, okay? Then the other most important is the method should have appropriate sensitivity and the specificity. Okay, that's the most important expectation. The next is factor to be considered, the next important part is functional activities. So the functional assays, there are two ways. One is complement to the physicochemical analysis, that is most important. And it is quantitative to measure the function of the protein. So here comes selection of most important. So you have targeted your product for oncology, then your functional assays where you are deriving a potency and a binding efficacy should be appropriate. You cannot use a kind of a different functionality assay stating that, okay, this is receptor based, but that receptor is not at all, valid for your functionality or your disease etiology, then it is really difficult to justify with to the regulator. So it is always, it should be similar and which should reflect your disease etiology. That's the most important point. Then multifunctional analysis is performed generally to show that to show the similarity. Okay, so those are the couple of activities. Then where the functionality activity can be measured more than one, like enzyme kinetics and other aspects, comparative characterization of the each parameter between the product should be assessed. Okay. Coming to the next important part is the target binding. So here generally people are using surface plasma resonance and microcalorimetry. So what exactly it reflects? So SPR is one of the beautiful technique where I can see the minor differences in the binding capacity, I should say, to the receptor. So what you do there is you will code the receptor on the plate, then you are putting an antibody or a monoclonal antibody, then we will look into that, okay, what is the binding affinity? So the kon, koff, and the kd value represent how my antibody binds to my intended receptor, how well it will take off from there, and what is the time period over there, and what is the kd value, like I mean to say, how much it binds. So everything will reflect in terms of a kind of an efficacy. It's a direct reflection of the efficacy, and any minor changes will significantly provide a difference in binding efficacy. That's the most important point. So SPR is a beautiful technique to use on that. The next important point is impurities. So there are two most different impurities we are using. One is product related impurities and another is process related impurities. When I call it as a product related impurities, it includes host cell protein, host cell DNA, then any kind of leachables like protein A, protein L. So all these should be developed, and this is a part of your release assay rather than a characterization assay. That means, and every time when you release the batch, your host cell protein content should be very, very lesser than certain parts per millions, because your product is your protein. Any unnecessary protein will always trigger immunological responses. So your host cell protein should be well characterized, and the method should be developed, like very specific method should be developed to identify parts per million level of your host cell protein as well as host cell DNA. Then the process related impurity is your degradation. Wherever when there is a size exclusion, you will look for aggregates. When there is a charge variant, you will look for acidic and basic variants. And there are multiple assays, like when you go for a reverse phase, you will look for oxidation and other impurities. When you look for SDS phase, like CSDS, reduced, you will look for a truncated and heavy chain, light chain related impurities. So these are the things impurities thoroughly you should monitor. And each and every quality attribute should be, you have to have a matching, like fingerprinting matching kind of a profile. So here, one of the important part is I can say I don't have any impurities. I don't have any charging variant and basic variant. So that doesn't suffice, because here,
hello, I think your audio is lost.
Efficacy directly. So in that perspective, we need to establish a reference standard, well qualified reference standard, to prove the relative potency. So the stages is initial reference standard you can take where during the development, It's like you can take any reference lot. Then you have to prepare your in-house reference standard from the early developmental batches. Then you can go for actual reference standard from the clinical lots. So here, the relative potency is generally go for a 95% confidence interval with the range of 90 to 110. Whereas your assay range would be 80 to 125, 70 to 130, depending on the assay variability. But like reference standard always should fall between 90 to 110. Okay. Next part is for the comparability purpose, how many reference products should be used? So the expectation of the regulators are 10 different, minimum 10 different lot of reference standards should be used. Okay. So how to get this 10 different reference standards? So your whole program goes for 5 years. In that perspective, we have to take like gradually purchase many lot of reference product and go on evaluating the critical quality attributes and have a data on that. Then whenever your product comes in, you can do as much as possible head-on comparison to compensate the similarity and establish, I should say, bracketing, a limit of, it's not a one-sided limit, establish a two-sided limit. For example, charge variant, it should be 20 to 30%, something like that. Okay, so that is most important. Then there is, as I mentioned earlier, the age of reference standard also matters. And if there is a limited number, sometimes what happens for the rare diseases, the manufacturer itself will produce one lot and it will suffice for at least 1 or 2 years. In that case, you can approach to regulators and state that, even though I am willing to do more work, but I don't have any reference standard. So this is how I have done my comparability. So probably that kind of justification will be accepted by regulators. I'm just once again the similar adding from the product level also, at least we should have 6 to 10 lots. So I talked on the reference. Now, how many products that too in the plant level can be used? I mean to say that too at the commercial scale level should be evaluated is minimum 6 to 10 lots. So that is much necessary once again to have a confidence on the biosimilarity perspective. So there are multiple stages. So we have investigational scale process, like that's the first level of establishment, or I can call it as a tech trans, then commercial scale, then it go to the validation lot. So all these put together, when we reach to certain level, so minimum 6 to 10 lots data should be available to the regulators along with 10 lots data of innovators. So that would eventually give a kind of a confidence that, so I have produced multiple batches. My quality is having very similar to each and every batch. That's the most important part. Then going for a data analysis. Okay, you have now a huge amount of data each and everywhere. And wherever you are observing similarities as well as sometimes dissimilarities. So now how to represent to the regulator? Okay, lot of tests. So what is important for me and what is my, like, it's like how to represent to convince my regulator that there are some differences in certain tests, but it's okay, I can justify those one. So for that, the major step is determine the quality attributes that characterize the reference product in terms of structural and physicochemical functional properties. Then we have to rank the attributes. So that's most important. So how do you rank? It is based on the risk to potentially impact on the PK/PD, safety and efficacy and immunogenicity. So this is the most important part. How best you rank, then that would eventually show to the regulator that, okay, the top four parameters are well comparable. That has high risk, I should say, and the down, wherever you have a couple of parameters which is dissimilar, but eventually it is not impacting my product quality. That's how we need to show. So the third step is thoroughly evaluate the attributes using the quantitative analysis and risk ranking and prepare a good report. Okay. So like the same part I have covered, little bit elaborative, like to evaluate the rank of product quality attribute in terms of potential impact, and that is attribute to high, low, medium kind of thing you can categorize, and degree of uncertainty is also should be added into that, and like the risk ranking should be well justified. How did you done that? That's the most important. The next part is like, once again, quantitative and qualitative data analysis. So once again, that is well defined. There is kind of a quality range people are, and that is defined by certain formulas. So everything is well defined in the guidance. So whenever you have comprehensive data, you have to apply the statistics. So here comes, I should say, most important role of the statistics. Extensively, people are using statistical analysis in terms of confidence interval, in terms of SDs, like in certain attributes, it should be plus or 2SD. In certain attributes, you can go for 3SD. So these are the couple of, like I should say, tools, statistical tools, many people are using on that, okay? Then, so final comparative analytical assessment should comprise of risk ranking attributes, type of data evaluation to be used, final data of analysis, then rationally of why the proposed number of lots should be okay. Then kind of we have to submit to the plan, like PR initiation of the analytical assessments, okay? Yes, this is also I have covered once again. So any change in the manufacturing, last sentence, what it states is a change in the manufacturing of biosimilar to resolve the difference observed, which provides observed difference were resolved and the quality attributes were not substantially affected. So the statement which goes whenever there is a change in the manufacturing process, it should be thoroughly justified. So like kind of a flow, if I put like iteration of the quality attributes is most important, then you have to define your quality target profile for characterization of reference and process, then the risk identification and risk ranking, then analytical assessment plan based on that, then characterization characterization of both RID and our product, then the data analysis. Okay. So this is about the expectations. So these are like when you start your biosimilar development, you have to holistically, comprehensively look, you should look into these aspects, and your plan should be well aligned with all the expectation of the regulators. So then you can have to have a very good plan of action, and gradually it should be executed. Let's look into some of the case studies where the innovators or biosimilar companies faced some kind of challenges, and they have how they have defended. So see, this is I'm just giving you the attributes, like what are the different quality attributes, like primary structure, there are peptide mapping, amino acid analysis, intact mass and reduced and deglycosylated mass will represent a primary structure. Protein content, then higher order structure can be proved into near UV, FTIR, then HRMS. Then size variant with the multiple technique, charge and glycosylation will be like can be done with the multiple different techniques. Followed by potency, binding assay, bioassay, subphysical particle, and general property. So if you look at that, all together, more than 30 to 35 different types of methods should be used kind of to define your quality attributes, I should say, for a comparability perspective. So from primary structure to various structure to like affinity and binding assays, everything, potency and binding assays should be defined. So wherever there is a monoclonal antibodies are involved. You have to work out with Fc receptors like Fc gamma, Fc RN, C1Q. There are multiple receptor, well-defined receptors are there that needs to be looked into. So when the bioassay perspective, based on the mechanism of action, you need to target ADCC, CDC, TNF-alpha. So there are multiple assays. So you need to target based on those assays and prove the biosimilarity perspective. Now, this is one of the case study where if you look that there is slight difference in the charge variant, right? So the top one is innovator, the bottom one is innovator, the in between is out, like I mean to say, biosimilar companies. So if you can observe that there is slight variance in the variation observed in the basic variant, it appears to be low. Okay, so how it would be defined, right? So they have analyzed multiple lot of, reference listed drug versus our product, okay? Then they put it into a kind of a representation of the statistical evaluation, where if you look at that, the basic variant showing a significant difference, whereas acidic variant and main peak are a little bit okay on this part. So they have given a nice justification on that. What is that justification? So the variation is due to the clipping of C-terminal lysine, okay? So this is very common for NATs. Any kind of such clippings are very common in NAT. It does not affect any kind of potency. So acidic peaks are due to deamidation, glycation, and fragmentation. So slight increase in the level of acidic peaks have minimum effect, okay? So this is the justification the biosimilar company has been given. Similarly, the glycan comparability. When you look into the silylation, there is absolutely a difference, okay? When you look into the total acetylation, it's more or less similar. High mannose, most important component, looks to be very much similar. Galactosylation is also very much similar. However, certain components are moving into different way. So considering all this differences observed with the high mannose and total acetylation. So in this aspect, we have to prove this by the functionality assessment. So that functionality assessment has been shown with similar PK profile, part number one, then similar ADCC activity, CDC activity, and TNF alpha binding. So when you look at your product, okay, the mid one is biosimilar product, and the left and right is US and Europe product from the same innovator. So when I compare from my functionality perspective, even though I'm having a difference in the glycan comparison, but here I'm proving that with that change in the glycan comparability, my functionality doesn't change. So keeping into the consideration of no change in the functionality, we can say that no clinically meaningful consequences are expected due to the minor difference in the glycan. That's the final statement, and the verdict has been like stated in the defense by the biosimilars. So the next part I'm touching upon the quality attributes of the clinical relevance. How do you put the quality attributes? Like for the primary structure, which are those? What is the potential impact? Then what is the biosimilarity perspective? When I looked into one product, so everything is matching, but there are two areas where I am not matching. That is sec HPLC as well as that's related to the size. Okay, so this where it is affecting. When I'm having a difference in the like aggregates, it may affect efficacy and the immunogenicity. That's the most important, right? So next is also non-reducing CSDS. So where they have observed certain amount of truncated one. So that is eventually reflecting on efficacy. So what is the potential impact? It is moderate. And in case of like aggregation, it is high to low because it is touching the immunogenicity. So that's most important. So this is a comparative kind of a peptide mapping. It looks to be very much similar. This has to be like thoroughly, it should be done. When they looked into the size exclusion, absolutely there is a difference between high molecular weight. It was bit more. Okay. So the clinical relevance of the high molecular, low molecular is in relation to the immunogenicity was assessed through repeat dose studies and was shown not to be clinically meaningful. So what they adopted is they did repeat dose toxicological studies, immunogenicity assessment studies, and prove that having a differential sizes, I mean to say aggregates, little bit more aggregates, eventually has not shown any immunogenic impact. So you have to perform multiple in vitro, in vivo, and kind of ex vivo studies to prove your differential characteristics. So here they did in vivo experiment, okay? The next important part, this is one of the very good example where the IEC profile appears to be changing. Okay. However, innovator have shown that even though there is a change in the IC profile, but when drug enters into the mechanistic action happens where this will degrade and like go back to the original composition or a profiling of the biosimilar. So this is the most important part one has to. So we have to look into the multiple aspects. So we are only working on outside, but what happens when it reaches to a systemic circulation is also an interesting case study. Okay, one more related to the glycan profiling. So here also they have given a good justification based on the like receptor binding study, like FC gamma and C1q. Okay. So the receptor binding study, I'm just giving an example how it looks to be. Like for example, when they did that experiment, the KD values are absolutely matching like anything, like 99 and 90 is always good. Okay. There is a huge variability observed when we perform the KD value. Okay, so once again they put it into everything like FC gamma binding, then FC R1B like 2A 3B. So most of there, if you look at that, they are well within the defined range of the innovators. So by performing such kind of in vitro experimentation, which is very much relevant to your changed quality attributes, we can prove that even though there is a slight change in my profile versus innovator, but with the binding assays, with the other in vivo experiments, we can prove that it does not affect my quality, safety, and efficacy. And I should say safety, efficacy, and immunogenicity. So that is the most important conclusion. Okay. Further, they did a functionality assay, that is TNF alpha neutralization, then binding, then cell-based binding affinity. So like this, we have to work a lot to prove the biosimilarity. That's most important. Whenever it comes to a change, we should not frightened. Okay, I'm not producing a very much biosimilar product, But if you know that, what is that component, and if you know that, how it is changing, and what is the impact, kind of a final impact on safety, efficacy, and immunogenicity. So you should establish well correlated functionality assays to defend that any minor changes eventually won't impact it on my final product quality. Okay, so just to conclude, like establishing that analytical comparability with innovator products to prove the biosimilarity for biologics is really a challenging task. So the huge amount of effort go on. So each and everywhere you will face, starting from the development to developing multiple assays and like proving a consistent performance of your method is really challenging. Okay, so unlike small molecules, biological products are complex drugs where the product has inherent minor differences within and between the manufacturing lots as a result of like it's made from the living system. So there is always, it's inevitable to control any minor changes. To ensure the high degree of the similarity, so biosimilar must undergo comparability exercise at every step of its development to demonstrate that potential difference from the reference product are not clinically meaningful with regard to the quality, safety, and efficacy. This is the most important. Starting from the development, you understand the profile. We have to know how my product is working, what is the differential attributes, how it is impacting on the safety and efficacy. That we have to know from the initial perspective. And the same thing can be discussed with the regulators. They are very much open. We can discuss with them, this is what the difference I am observing, and this is how I'm going to defend it. Okay, so the current expectation from the regulatory is that appropriate, highly advanced analytical tools should be employed for assessing the critical quality attributes of the product qualitatively as well as quantitatively to establish the equivalence in terms of primary, secondary, and tertiary structure, and also similar functional and biological properties. So this is what the expectation, and I have also presented the challenges and the defense, how the biosimilar companies have defended their minor changes. So with this, I would like to thank to the organizers, NIPR committee, given an opportunity to present my experience. So here I'm stopping and open to the discussion.